Headline Audio presents The Heathrow Doctor by Dr. Stephanie Green. Read for you by Heather Long.
Hello, Port Health. Dr. Green here. This is Control. We've had a call from Emirates flight EK355 from Singapore, due to land at 7 a.m. Death on board.
It was 4 a.m. when the call had come, jolting me awake. Immediately, my heart was thumping a steady rhythm as I heard the man's voice, but knowing my name and where I was felt like a positive start to the conversation. Always the same sleepy thought. Who exactly are Control and where are they based? Even after more than a decade of working as a doctor at the Health Control Unit, HCU, at Heathrow, I never really did find out. As far as I was concerned, they were centrally located and they knew things. They were disembodied voices, sporadically generating work for the small band of people working in HCU. Radiographers, health control officers, HCOs, duty officers, DOs, and me. Any other details? I was sitting up in bed now.
It was something out of the ordinary. The crew were very distressed. They contacted Medilink, the company supplying medical assistance over the phone, after a passenger collapsed and were advised to carry out CPR, which was unsuccessful.
Out of the ordinary?
Will you be attending the flight, Doctor?
Control were never big on small talk.
I will, yes. Please make sure passengers and crew remain on board until we arrive. Can you also let us know which stand the flight is coming in on, with as much notice as possible? Will do.
I hung up the phone and flopped back onto my pillow. I'd never get back to sleep now. I'd been on the go since 10 a.m. the previous day, 16 hours straight, virtually non-stop, and though my body was exhausted, my mind tended to leap out of the paddock and gallop around like mad whenever I got a call like this. It was always the same, mental checklists and action plans, which generally segued into second-guessing decisions I'd made earlier that day. Had I missed something from that last X-ray when I was tired? Should I have sent the elderly man with a chest infection straight to hospital? I was usually fairly certain of my decisions when I made them, but things always seemed worse in those first few waking minutes. Anxiety heightened. Why was that? And what the hell did out of the ordinary mean? Yes, people got sick on planes and occasionally people died on them, but for the crew to be so distressed, it set my mind wondering if this death had been the result of an act of violence, or could it have even been self-inflicted? I'd have got up straight away if I hadn't been freezing cold. Despite swaddling my body in five of the finest hospital blankets HCU had to offer, I still felt like I was in the depths of a Siberian winter rather than a mild March morning in London. Heathrow has its own microclimate with refrigerated air pumped through it whatever the season, so the temperature of my modest sleeping quarters in Terminal 4 rarely reached tepid at the best of times, and the itchy green blankets held little to no heat. I shouldn't have complained. Once the final flight had landed each night, the night duty doctor was the only person in the whole airport who was afforded the luxury of a bed. Although luxury might be pushing it as far as this particular cot went. Mandy and June, the pair of HCOs who had to doze in their chairs in the restroom outside, weren't so lucky. It's funny. Despite the fact that 650 flights landed at Heathrow every day, with at least one death on board a month, I never really got used to it. It wasn't so much the death part that unsettled me. As a doctor, you become fairly immune to that. It was everything that went with the attendance of death. Boarding a plane full of people to do my job was like performing in front of an audience, with a couple of hundred troubled eyes boring into me the whole time I worked. It always made me nervous, and with good reason. I was essentially holding an entire plane load of passengers against their will, and having just sat through a long-haul flight with a dead body, many of them weren't all that chuffed about it. In a case where there was a body on board, passengers weren't even allowed to move out of their seats until I'd confirmed the passenger was indeed dead, and not from something that could threaten the health of the other passengers, or anyone else they might come into contact with after leaving the plane. That was one of the biggest challenges for the team at Port Health, which is the umbrella title for the entire medical team working at Heathrow's HCU. Protecting the public from the entry of infectious disease into the UK. My concern when somebody died on an inbound flight was to get to the bottom of the cause before I could send the passengers out into the world, and ruling out the really scary stuff was paramount. Viral hemorrhagic fevers such as Lassa fever, Marburg disease, or even Ebola, which 10 years into my job at Heathrow we'd never had a case of in the UK. And once I was on board the plane, this all had to be executed quickly and with absolute authority. Over the years, this important drill became more performance than procedure for me, and with a tightly constructed and vigorously rehearsed script, I'd planned precisely what I was going to say and do before I even set foot on board. I habitually ran a mental checklist of all the items I needed to have with me too, every time I did it. Pocket torch, gloves, stethoscope and thermometer. If, heaven forbid, I forgot a piece of my kit and had to dash back to HCU, not only would I be holding up a plane load of very pissed off people, but flight schedules would be thrown off course into the bargain. Time was money. And if a plane were on the stand for even 5 minutes longer than scheduled, it could cost the airline concerned a fortune. June, are you out there? It was 45 minutes before the flight was due to come in, and I was up, showered and dressed, but for some reason, control still hadn't called back to let us know which stand the flight was due to land on. I'm here, Stephanie. June's Scottish burr rang from the chair on the other side of the door. What do you need? Well, I need to know where the plane's coming in, I said, as she came in bleary-eyed. Nothing from control yet, then? She asked. No, I think you'll have to call and put a rocket up them, I told her. We want to be waiting for the plane rather than the other way round. This sounds like something serious. I'm on it, she said. Soon as I've worked out how many cups of coffee it's going to take to make me feel like a proper human person again. No sleep again, June. I might as well be kipping on the runway for all the sleep I get in that bloody chair, she said. Do you want some coffee, Stephanie? If we have time, yes, please. Half an hour before the flight landed, control called to confirm that the plane would be arriving at Stand 18 in Terminal 3. The terminal was a 10-minute drive away, so I needed to get my act together fast. It was barely light when I headed down to my parking space and hopped into my car, but the airport was already waking up. Fuel tankers and empty baggage trucks were orbiting the airport as I drove into the tunnel under the runway that connected Terminal 4 with the central terminal area, where Terminals 1, 2 and 3 were. I headed for Terminal 3's HCU to pick up more staff who would accompany me onto the flight. All Heathrow doctors attended flights with these colleagues, just in case onboard surveillance had to be carried out. When a passenger had died or was sick from a suspected or unidentified infectious disease, we were required to collect details from the other passengers. Then, once the tests had been carried out to determine exactly what the disease was, passengers could be contacted if further action was required. Often, there would just be one HCO attending, but on that day there were two because of the size of the plane. An Emirates Airbus A380. Double-deck, wide-body. The largest passenger airline in the world at the time. My attending officers that morning were Sinead and Megan. Between them, they clocked up years of working at the airport, and although they'd almost certainly attended far more deaths than I had, they still looked to me, the doctor, to take charge. This sounds like something quite nasty, Stephanie, Megan said as we headed out of HC. So I believe, I said. Buckle up, ladies. As the three of us headed through Terminal 3, passengers waiting in the lounges for their flight looked bemused at the sight of me striding purposefully along in my white doctor's coat, stethoscope around my neck as if I were about to stop and give a first aid demonstration outside Pret-a-Manger. I don't know why I always felt so dreadfully out of place walking through the public areas of the airport, but I did, and the nearer I got to the plane, the bigger my entourage got. Police, my pair of HCOs and a handful of airline staff to deal with the fallout of what may be about to unfold. I was a white-coated Pied Piper, gathering momentum as we approached the stand, while wide-eyed children clutched the hands of their rubbernecking parents, curious as to what the emergency might be. Then my least favourite part, waiting quietly on the jetty while the plane taxied slowly to its resting point. Those few empty minutes to reflect on what might be waiting for me beyond the plane doors. Some serious infectious disease? Some great risk to the UK? There was never a way of knowing until I stepped on board, and whatever it turned out to be, it was mine to deal with. Okay, here we go. I headed down the jetty, my new gang in tow, while the crew member operating the airbridge shouted at us to hold tight. He lined up the electric platform with the door of the plane with a joystick, and the moving walkway shifted beneath our feet like one of those fun houses at the fairground as we were manoeuvred towards the plane, jerking this way and that. When the airbridge was in place and the hood was suctioned around the plane door, the driver banged on the door to let the crew inside know he was in position. Then the door swung open, and I was greeted by the purser. Port Health? She looked relieved to see me. Yes, Dr. Green, I said. I glanced over her shoulder into the eyes of a tearful young stewardess who was steadying herself on the arm of a male colleague. Thank you for coming so quickly, Doctor, the purser said. It's been a bit of a rough night. So I can see, I said, my gaze still fixed on the girl. Is she okay? I was used to seeing the cabin crew looking immaculate as I entered a plane, but this poor stewardess looked anything but, and had what I feared was blood down the front of her shirt. What the hell had happened on this plane? I pulled my gaze away from the blood-stained stewardess and once again turned my attention to the purser, whose pristine makeup, hair and attire, after a traumatic overnight long-haul flight, stood in stark contrast against the pale, exhausted apparition with no makeup and hair, scraped back in a ponytail standing before her. Me. "The gentleman is lying in one of the galleys, which we've closed off," she said. I stepped onto the plane with Sinead and Megan close behind me. "Could one of you find the man's passport to get his details for our records, please?" I asked Megan. "Yes, Stephanie." I whispered a tiny prayer of thanks when the purser told me that the body was in the galley closest to the front, covered with a blanket. At least I only needed to walk past the first few rows, rather than the entire length of the silent plane with 300 pairs of eyes trained squarely on me, so I wouldn't be recording death in the cabin in full view. It was always daunting, boarding a plane to confirm a death. I was acutely aware that everyone was looking to me to decide, or at the very least make an educated guess about what the passenger had died of, and to make the call on whether or not it was safe for everyone to disembark. It was all about me, in fact, and never a responsibility I took lightly. You'd be surprised at how many passengers get stroppy at the idea of being held back from immediately disembarking, despite the gravity of an onboard death. I'd experienced people refusing to sit down or even listen to my announcements on some flights, too eager to jump up and retrieve their belongings from the overhead lockers to care about anything else that was going on. On one flight from Pakistan, I thought the passengers looked as if they were ready to charge the doors if I kept them much longer. It was for this reason that I tried never to make eye contact with the passengers unless absolutely necessary. I looked straight ahead as I made my way along the aisle. I didn't want to invite questions of any sort. All I wanted was to get the job done and get off the plane. Even after 10 years, I never found it easy treating a sick passenger on a flight. Undoing their clothes, checking their vital signs and listening to their heart, all under the watchful eyes of everyone else on board. It's a difficult place to work and the antithesis of what you get used to in the privacy of a consulting room. It's medicine on view, and it really affects your practice. Quick diagnoses, quick decisions about whether I can get the patient back to the unit where I can examine them properly and in private. I wasn't one for attending flights in full protective clothing either, as some doctors did. I imagined it would terrify the life out of everybody on board, seeing me striding down the aisle in full protective get-up, so I didn't wear it unless absolutely crucial. I usually wore my white doctor's coat and gloves and carried my torch and thermometer, not that there was going to be much need for a thermometer on this particular occasion. "He's in here," the purser said, stepping aside to let me into the galley. "We all did the best we could." "I'm sure you did," I said. "Thank you." I'd seen a fair few bodies in my time, but this one was a particularly shocking sight. Probably the most disturbing I'd ever seen, certainly on a plane. The entire front of the man was covered in blood. His mouth and nostrils were caked with dried blood as well. He was a slim man and obviously wasn't that old, maybe early 50s. His skin was waxy, but his face was slightly red and flushed, unusual for the dead. And his T-shirt was also covered in dry blood, which had turned a familiar dusky brown. When there's a lot of blood but no wound, the blood has usually come from somewhere in the gut, and that seemed to be the case here. It was clear that the man was dead. No one would have needed to examine him closely to determine that. But there's a particular process I had to go through before I could confirm the death. I gathered myself and listened for breath and heart sounds, and then I shone my torch into his pupils, which were fixed, dilated, and non-reactive to light. No brainstem working. I recorded the death, making a note of the time and informing Sinead, and then covered the man's face with the blanket again. Back outside the galley, the purser introduced me to the young woman who'd dealt with the situation, the tear and blood-streaked stewardess I'd seen as I got on, whose name was Cassie. "Cassie, I'm Dr. Green. How are you doing?" "I'm a bit calmer now, but it was really horrible," she said. "There's no privacy on a plane, nowhere to talk. Everyone's eyes were on us, so we had to duck back behind the galley area to keep the details as private as possible, although I made sure Cassie was facing away from the body so she didn't have to look at him again, even covered up with a blanket. "Can you tell me what happened?" I asked, calm but firm. "What were the first signs that something was wrong?" "He seemed fine at first, but said he didn't want any food as he was feeling sick, just water. Then he got up and went to one of the bathrooms and was there for quite a while. And what happened after that? I said softly. He came out a bit later. He was vomiting blood, all blood, loads of it. The look on his face, so frightened. I was frightened. I rushed to help him, but he fell on the floor and seemed to lose consciousness very quickly. I did everything I could, Doctor. I looked down at her clothes, where she had obviously tried to clean off the man's splattered blood. Of course you did. I called the other crew over, but there was still more blood, so we put out the call for a doctor on board, but there was no one, so... Cassie trailed off, breathing in and out deeply. You called Medilink. The purser called Medilink, yes, and they recommended we start CPR, which we tried, but it was so difficult because of all the bleeding. The man had begun vomiting pure, fresh blood 38,000 feet up and never stopped. Vomiting after massive internal bleeding, hematemesis, to give it its technical name, is a horrible way to die. There were two likely causes: a gastric ulcer eroding into an artery, or ruptured esophageal varices, which are swollen veins usually caused by alcoholism that can swell until they burst, causing copious bleeding. It must have been terrifying to know you were internally bleeding in an aeroplane with no help at hand. It would have been a grisly sight for the surrounding passengers too. In hematemesis, a lot of blood is lost very quickly and visibly. It's a catastrophic event and often fatal, even in the safety of a hospital, let alone the aisle of a plane in mid-flight. There's very little anyone could have done. In a hospital, the man might have been rushed into surgery for banding of the varices, where the surgeon uses an endoscope to find the bleeding veins and applies rubber bands to them, or had a special gadget with a balloon on the end inserted into his esophagus, then inflated in an attempt to compress the vessels and stop the bleeding. It's hard enough for medical professionals to deal with that amount of blood, let alone the untrained airline crew with no equipment. Generally, people who die on flights do so quickly and with a lot less mess, so I really felt for this brave stewardess who had stayed with the man until the end. We carried him, well, we sort of dragged him into the galley so he was out of sight of the other passengers, Cassie went on. Thank God a lot of them were asleep by then. But you were wearing gloves, I said. Yes, from the medical kit. And you're sure none of the blood came into direct contact with your skin or into any cuts you might have? I'm pretty sure, and I've cleaned myself up as much as I can, she said. Okay, make sure anything with blood on is disposed of as hazardous waste, I said. Cassie nodded, still teary-eyed. I absolutely will. There's nothing more you could have done for him, I said, offering a smile. You did everything you possibly could have. It struck me as odd, not to mention unfortunate, that there was no doctor on board, which was hardly ever the case on flights I've attended. In fact, it's always my dread when I'm travelling somewhere by plane that I'll get called upon to assist in an emergency mid-flight after a couple of gin and tonics. Doctors have a duty to help if called upon and to do whatever is within their capability at that moment. On this flight, I was simply there to rule out an infectious disease or anything suspicious and then to record his death. So as far as those things went, my job was done. I thanked the other members of the crew for their quick thinking and diligence in a tough situation, and then headed to the front of the plane, passing on all the relevant information to the onboard staff and the two police officers, who also had to be there to attend the death. As I was about to disembark, the pilot emerged from the cockpit. Thanks, Doctor. Is there anything else you need? I don't think so, I said. There's no reason to suspect an infectious cause of death, so we won't need to get everyone's details. You can disembark the passengers now. It does sometimes feel a little strange, telling the pilot what can and can't happen on their plane, but technically my authority overrides theirs in these situations, and they are looking to me to make a decision, so I don't have much choice. I never learned anything personal about the man who died, except that he had a passport from the United Arab Emirates and that he had been travelling alone. My only concern was to try to determine the cause of his death, or at least exclude an infectious one. The authorities would handle all his personal information once they had his name and passport number. They would also handle the practicalities like contacting the UAE embassy and forwarding his luggage. So much of what we doctors did, even in a setting as dramatic as Heathrow, was mechanical. Our X-ray machines whirred away, verifying diseases or concealed drugs. Pregnancies were confirmed with the touch of a belly. People with unidentified symptoms were quarantined. It's not the medicine that was fascinating and unique, but the people on whom we practiced. That's why each time I recorded a death, I always wrote rest in peace in my notes after the name of the deceased. As a new doctor, I had learned this practice from a senior colleague who always did the same, and it just struck me as the right thing to do. A tiny bit of humanity that comes in where the medicine ends, and an acknowledgement that this was a real person with a family, friends, a home and a life. Rest in peace. Chapter 1. Top Secret. It wasn't part of some grand plan to become a doctor, but then I was never one for plans, grand or otherwise. In truth, I had no idea what I wanted to do when I left school, and I certainly hadn't considered medicine, at least no more than I'd considered anything else. I kicked off my university career on a degree course in natural sciences, which turned out to be a serious undertaking and far too much like hard work. Monday to Friday, 9 to 4, and Saturday mornings. I realised that this outlandish schedule would totally cramp my style in terms of drinking and partying, but in the end, it was drinking and partying that won the day. In fact, I only ever made one Saturday lecture in the first year. So, in my second and third year, I swapped to biological anthropology. Now, I'd like to be able to tell you that I had a calling to specialise in the biological evolution of the human race, but in truth, it was a much easier degree, involving about 4 hours a week of lectures. Apparently, Prince Charles had done it as part of his degree. Still, I had 3 years at Downing College, Cambridge, which was good enough for me, and I made the most of it. Besides the partying, I did work extremely hard while I was at university. Despite still not having a clue where I was headed career-wise, I knew that whatever it was, I wanted to be good at it, the best, and to be the best, I needed all the mental ammunition I could soak up. Most of my work experience so far had been in retail, with my first full-time job working in my mother's and stepfather's shop. They'd recently given up their jobs, moving from Chester, where I grew up, and bought the village store in Ulverston, West Gloucestershire, where I worked the summer I left Cambridge. My parents had divorced when I was 7, and my mum, Hilary, married my stepfather, Ian, a couple of years later, so I'd grown up with him. By the time I was ready for senior school, they'd already had 2 more children while I'd been accepted to an all-girls private school. This wasn't something my parents would have been able to fund themselves, but I'd achieved high marks in the entrance exam, so I was lucky enough to be offered a government-assisted place. Still, I always had weekend and holiday jobs, babysitting, shop work or whatever was going because I liked having financial independence, and this approach carried me right through my school years to my time at Cambridge. Back then, of course, there weren't the huge fees that often plunge students into debt for years, but like any student, I had living costs. Still, I remained self-sufficient, preferring to make my own cash instead of relying on the bank of mum and dad. I probably wasn't the greatest shop assistant in the world, but I enjoyed the work and put my back into it, as I did into everything. I might have had a solidly middle-class upbringing, and I'm so grateful for the encouragement and support both my parents gave me, but I certainly wasn't born with the proverbial silver spoon in my mouth. Like many Cambridge students, I took the civil service exams in my final year. The government often invited those with the highest scores to become top-level civil servants, and I quite liked the idea of working in the Foreign Office. About a week after the exam, an unmarked envelope appeared in my college pigeonhole with a letter asking if I'd be interested in what they described as an alternative foreign service career. No explanation of what it might be, nothing. All it did say was that if I were at all interested, I was to go for an interview at an address in Whitehall the following week. At the bottom of the page lay a sinister instruction in bold capitals. Please do not tell anyone about this letter. All very intriguing for a 21-year-old with a sense of adventure, so, of course, I signed up and went along. All along Whitehall are imposing classical white stone buildings, but I was directed to what must have been the smallest door in Christendom and greeted by a smiling, neat woman adorned in twinset and pearls, a dead ringer for Miss Moneypenny, who led me inside. The interior of the building was nothing less than palatial, with majestic artwork and chandeliers agogo. I was both thrilled and daunted in equal measure. Moneypenny then led me to a room that was anything but palatial. A couple of chairs, a table, and not much else. But she said nothing. Sitting at the table was a man who offered me a seat, a cup of coffee, and a copy of the Official Secrets Act to sign, but no inkling of what I was there for. My mind started racing. Should I read this through? Should I just sign it? I decided that I didn't have much choice. It would be undignified to make a bolt for it, and as nervous as I was also dying to know where all this was heading. So there I was, signing the Official Secrets Act, with no idea why. What could possibly go wrong? I handed the papers to the man, who then gave me a dossier on which every single page was stamped in bold red, Top Secret. I peered down at it, wondering what on earth might be expected of me. Was this someone's idea of an elaborate joke, or had I stumbled onto the set of a cut-price Bond movie? I suddenly felt small in the midst of it all. Nobody had explained a single thing to me about why I was there and what the position was. All they'd said was, sit down, sign this, read this. I remember thinking how ludicrous it was that an important government document should have those great big red words plastered all over it if they didn't want people to bloody well read it. Surely, if one sees the word top secret stamped across something, the first thing one wants to do is have a good gander at it. My head was spinning as the man went on to ask me questions about my parents. We know your father has been in Poland, he said. The man was referring to my father, Paul, who was a biochemist. Poland was still behind the Iron Curtain back then, and while employed by a drug company, he'd travelled there for work. The man also asked about my parents' affiliations and politics, before suggesting that I go home, discuss all this with them, and think carefully about whether I was interested in the position. Yes, I was allowed to tell them about the job, just as long as I didn't do it over the phone. Seriously? Was the college phone really tapped? It all seemed wildly over the top, but I thought it best to do as they said, just in case it was, and I ended up being shipped off to a small island, never to be heard from again. As I travelled home, my mind was going in all directions. I imagined myself spying in a foreign country, living on my danger money. If I took whatever job it was they were offering, I would move country every 3 years, and I could only ever tell my husband and parents what I was doing. Absolutely nobody else could know. I wrote to my mother and father in the end, melodramatically advising them to shred and dispose of the letter the very second they read it. In the same spirit, Dad wrote back to me instructing me to eat his letter when I'd read it. We all got into the drama of it. Mum thought it was brilliant. You'll meet really interesting people, darling, she wrote, clearly not taking into consideration that some interesting people might want to waterboard me to extract official secrets. Dad, on the other hand, was a little more cautious. Will you have to kill anyone? Because that's something to think about. As much as I loved the idea of all that excitement, in my heart I knew I could never have accepted the position, because I could never live a lie. How could I ever have any genuine friendships or get close to people? There would always be a barrier, and that, more than anything, turned me off the idea, and I turned them down. I never really found out for sure why I'd been singled out to become a spy for MI6, but I'd heard from a reasonably reliable source that one of my senior tutors at Cambridge was a recruiter who earmarked prospective candidates and pointed them out to the powers that be. I couldn't know for sure if that was the reason, but I always thought it had a ring of truth because there was quite a tradition of spies coming from Cambridge. Back then, the Secret Service was secret, and there was no acknowledgement that it even existed. These days, it's relatively out in the open with MI6 advertising their positions in the Times. There's just no mystery anymore, is there? The bottom line is, I might have been a spy rather than a doctor, and my children still love the idea of it. How do you know I'm not a spy? I once asked them. I wouldn't be allowed to tell you if I was, and if I did tell you, I'd probably have to kill you. Post-degree, I ended up working in the city at Anderson Consulting, a huge global management consultancy firm. I chose them because A, they offered the most money, and B, because they said they'd send me to Chicago for 6 weeks for training, and I quite fancieded that. So at 21, I was seconded to a team working at the London Stock Exchange, but my heart really wasn't in it. In fact, despite making a ton of money, I hated every second of being in the city. I didn't like running with the crowd. I hated sitting in dreary meetings, and I had a frighteningly low tolerance for all the management bullshit speak I had to endure on a daily basis. I didn't fit into that world, nor did I want to, and I quickly realised that it wasn't for me. I managed to stick it out for 2 years, but then it was time to go. You might be surprised to hear how I decided on my career in medicine. It wasn't something that came to me in a vivid dream or even a true calling to do something worthwhile for humanity. I actually just picked it out of a book. If you were leaving Anderson's, they had a rather generous policy known as counselling out, where they allowed you a couple of months on full pay to look into what you wanted to do next. I think this was because they realised that a career in management consultancy wasn't for everyone and wanted to help those who were leaving to find their feet again. Consequently, as I was working in London, I found myself in the University College London careers section for hours on end, trawling through every conceivable option. I ploughed through every folder from A to Z to see what might take my fancy. It wasn't as much roulette as it was pin the tail on the donkey, because the truth of it was I had absolutely no idea what I wanted to do. This realisation came with a huge amount of anxiety. Why didn't I know? Why didn't I have a vocation? Why wasn't there a burning passion pulling me towards a new and exciting threshold? I didn't know the answer to these questions, but after many hours in the careers section, I found myself staring at what seemed like two viable options for someone with my scientific background. Veterinarian or doctor. Okay, so what now? Maybe I'd have to experience some time looking at both before I decided. That seemed sensible. First, I went and spent a day with a family friend, a vet who spent an unsettling amount of time in freezing cold fields with his arm up cows' backsides. No, I wasn't going to take any delight in that. In fact, it was a hideous day and one that I didn't feel needed revisiting. After that, I spent a day with a GP in Axminster, a lovely man with a small, established practice who, after work, took me to his house where we sat by the fire with his Springer Spaniels and a gin and tonic each, while he recounted absorbing stories about his long career in medicine. Oh yes, I decided, this was much better. Warm fires and grateful patients as opposed to sub-zero fields and cows' arses. Done. Since then, of course, I've considered the idea that I might have had a great day with my vet friend the very next day and a vile time with the doctor, and I can say with some certainty that if that had been the case, I'd have become a vet. There'd been no childhood dream about either career, and on top of that, starting medicine aged 23 with absolutely no background or training in it was quite an undertaking. I suppose, if anything, that was what drew me to it, the challenge and the opportunity to do something worthwhile. Something that mattered. I loved learning more than anything, and the thing I was and still am best at is academia. I also loved the idea of going back to university, and who wouldn't? It was just more years of having no responsibility. My dad was horrified at the idea of me becoming a student again and not earning, but to be fair, I'd managed to save quite a bit of money from my time at Anderson's, and I funded my time at medical school by continuing to work as a freelance programmer, using the skills I'd learned as a management consultant. Of course, it made things easier that there were no tuition fees back then. I ended up doing an accelerated graduate course at Southampton University, which took 4 years and loved it, finally qualifying in 1998, when I was 29. Quite late, yes, but I think that maturity helped me cope better with the degree, particularly when I was on the wards as a medical student. Chapter 2, House Rules. On leaving university, newly qualified doctors were required to do house jobs as the initial part of their training. 6 months of general medicine, followed by another 6 of general surgery, during which time they could begin to decide in what kind of medicine they'd eventually like to specialise. As it happened, I'd already made that decision, having completed 2 psychiatry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.